This CDS520, which came from a storage facility in the Zurich area, is in functional state.
And yet it features the SX266 CPU, something I never came across and thought to be a rumour.
Obsolete computer technology is my passion. I'm the vintage collector and these are my stories.
While working on the restoration of this COMPAQ Presario CDS 520, I started to wonder about its CPU. I noticed already that it featured a 486SX. Now, there wouldn't be something special about an SX, and also Microsoft Diagnostics was not very specific about it. But eventually I noticed that it was an SX2, running at 66 MHz, so a clock multiplied 486 without the math coprocessor.
What's so special about it? I think these were quite common.
Yeah, maybe they were. Though, in all these years, I've never actually came across an SX2 myself. I've only ever seen 386SXs with 16 to 25 MHz clock speed, and also the 486SXs with 25 to 33 MHz clock speed. And although Wikipedia claims these existed, I've always thought them to be somewhat of a phantom.
Why would anyone document their existence if they didn't actually exist? And then again, it's common knowledge the SX was the access with disabled mass coprocessor because production yield was bad in the beginning of the 486.
Nah, I'm not so entirely sure about this statement. Let's look at the timeline. The 486DX appeared in 1989, but the SX variants didn't appear until in 1991 the first time. And what a coincidence, these came just about the same time when AMD, after disputing for 5 years in court over the right to produce 386 processors, finally won the right and brought their 386DX40 along. If the SX were in fact bad yields in the 486 production runs, then why wouldn't they appear early in the timeline? And could it be these were actually a response from Intel against the sudden competition from AMD? No, sir. I believe the SXs were gap fillers for the entry-level market. Wikipedia claims that these had the math coprocessor disabled in earlier versions and later on the coprocessor was removed. The latter statement goes along with some sources claiming the SX only having 900,000 transistors, while the DXs actually had 1.2 million transistors. The colleagues on OS2 Museum went into dinging it up and postulating their own theories, to which I mostly agree. Also, there's one post by a guy by the name of Alex Wachowski, claiming to be a former Intel engineer and providing further insights into the 486SX production process. Now, it's hard to prove that claim, but going from a critical distance, I wonder why a bad yield would make the low-cost SX CPU only appear 2 years after being in production already. I'm in favor into believing Alex's claim that it was done for mainly a price point. I would go even that far to assert that in 1992, the time for the 386 was pretty much over, and the SX competed against the AMD 386 CPU line. And overall, don't forget, the 386 was introduced in 1985.
That's pretty fast, but in that same 20th of a second, this 8386 microprocessor from Intel can perform 200,000 calculations. That's pretty fast too.
Ready, get set, go.
Even a 20 MHz 486 would be roughly double the speed of a 40 MHz 386, with the math coprocessor not really delivering a speed bump in most cases.
This hasn't even started yet.
That's right.
All right, who needs the power of a 486, John?
Who needs the power? Computer-aided design applications like this, database servers, virtual reality systems, multimedia.
So having the 486 totally made sense to hit the entry-level market segment in the 1991 period. And since the double-clock 486s were on the horizon for March 1992, it made sense to start reusing the former DX CPU production lines to make trimmed-down SX CPUs instead. Of course, this is only an assumption, but in my point of view, it's meaningless if the SX was having a faulty FPU. I'm into believing his statement that in the beginning, the FPU was simply disabled, and only a later revision actually removed the FPU from the lithographic process for cost savings. And this would go along perfectly with that documented claims on the SXs having 300,000 transistors less than the DX CPUs.
But then, the SX33 arrived only shortly before the DX266. This one must have been faulty and rebranded.
I didn't find any source to support that claim. And then again, the SX33 came after the DX266 and not before, so my opinion breaks as well the bad yields theory. It is still possible, as it's quite close on the timeline, though I think it weren't that easy to just cut a microscopically small wire to make a clock double CPU becoming a non-clock doubling CPU.
But then the SX2 must have been.
I don't think so as well. The SX2 50 and 66 arrived an entire 18 months after the DX2 66's introduction. The former came in March 1994, the latter debuted in August 1992. Nope, I don't think we're talking bad yield at all here. Rather, history repeating once again, bringing a faster low-end 486 without FPU for a pure cost point perspective. Having an Intel SX2 in 1994, especially at the time when they also introduced the DX4 models, while they had their own in-house high-end competition with the P5 and P54C in the race at the same time, makes only sense
when competing with AMD.
Yeah, probably exactly that. Because AMD brought their own AM486 SX2 in early 1994 as well. And it's well known that AMD used aggressive pricing, so having an SX2 themselves made totally sense for Intel. Now, I didn't find anything about actual sold number of units of either Intel or AMD for the SX2 CPUs. Still, and despite me never ever coming across one in the wild myself, they must have been produced in reasonable numbers. The question of course arises, how much of a performance difference would it make between the SX2 and the DX2? To assess that, I installed Sif Davies PC Magazine WinMark and ran it on both machines. Now, there were a few occasions where the benchmark assesses a better performance for the DX266. But in most cases, the results were only 1-2% apart from each other, which can still equate as measurement inaccuracies. Now, to be fully transparent here, I didn't run the full tests like 5 times to take the average results. I ran the tests only once as I only wanted to get more like a general direction. And it seems to be quite clear, and to no surprise, that the two CPUs are mostly identical, delivering equal performance, except in those areas where there's a clear benefit on the FPU for performing floating point operations. Now, WinMark also gave me the disk benchmarks, but these results are clearly not indicative. The DX266 seems to be way ahead of the SX266, but in reality, this actual mismatch is caused by the fact having a CF2-ID adapter in the Presario CDS 524, while the CDS 520 ran off a traditional ID hard drive. Having said that, to complement the results, I've also run a test series using Windows Magazine's WinTune. The results as shown here are from the current machine being the CDS 524 compared to the results taken from the CDS 520. Again, they're pretty much equal, with only small variations showing the CDS 524 just a tiny little bit ahead of the 520 with the SX 266 CPU in some areas. And just as a comparison, here's the result on trial against the Dell Dimension P90, which delivers roughly 3 times the performance of the 66MHz 486 machines.
Still a good find, as it sports the 486 SX266. I saw plenty of those SX25s and 33, but I never came across any SX CPU with 50MHz and more. I always believed them to be a rumour, but obviously these actually do exist. Well, what do you think? Did you ever come by an SX250 or SX266? Let me know in the comments below. I'm the Vintage Collector and this was my story for today. Thanks for watching and see you again Sunday next week.